Prevention is the Cure update, next on Enviro Close-Up. Welcome to Enviro Close-Up. I'm Carl Grossman. Cancer has become the world's leading cause of death, according to the World Health Organization. It used to be heart disease. Why the epidemic of cancer and how can it be stopped? With us is Karen Joy Miller, who believes prevention is the cure. We've spoken, we've done an Enviro Close-Up with Karen before, called Prevention is the Cure. Now we have Prevention is the Cure update. Hello, Karen.
Hi, Carl. Thank you so much. I'm glad to be back.
Karen, can you explain the Prevention is the Cure initiative?
Yes, it's been around since 1999. Actually, formally, it's been around since actually the late 80s. But we needed all those years to come up with those four simple words because we were always about prevention is the cure. There is no cure for disease. There is no immediate magic bullet for disease. Prevention can be the ultimate cure. And it takes all of us understanding how we can be part of this process and really lower the risk for disease. So we abide by the precautionary principle. We urge people to change their personal behaviors. And we want people to get involved in public policy. So as science begins to show us the cause and connections between environmental toxins and the onset of disease, we can do something about it, both personally and publicly.
On your website, Karen, you suggest 8 steps every person can take to reduce the risk of cancer and other diseases. Let's go through them one by one. First, avoid plastics.
So plastics are an endocrine disruptor, and science has now begun to show us that certain exposures to endocrine-disrupting chemicals can begin to damage or injure a gene, especially in the developing child. We call them windows of susceptibility. So basically, when we're developing in the womb, there is an exquisite mechanism that takes place. And if, in fact, it is interfered with by exposures to environmental chemicals in multiplicity, we can then have a child who later on in life will develop many different types of cancers or diabetes, autism, asthma, and so many terrible life-threatening diseases. We also know that exposures to environmental toxins are intergenerational. That means that maybe the exposures of our grandmother and mother can help increase the risk for breast cancer, but we can do something about it.
Then there's avoid exposure to toxic pesticides and toxic cleaning products.
Well, basically, same thing. Pesticides are an endocrine disruptor. We're seeing through Prevention is the Cure that endocrine disrupting compounds are really our target. We're looking at things like bisphenol A and parabens and phthalates and pesticides that come to us in common household products every day. And we want people to know what they are, to make the right choices, and to eliminate them from our lives. So basically, when it comes to pesticides, it's an easy fix. In the summer, when we use so many pesticides, take your shoes off before you come into the house. Don't track in the pesticides on the soles of your shoes so that your baby who's crawling around can pick up, they are really hand to mouth, and they pick up their cookies or their binkies and they put it into their mouths. And that has pesticides, which is a known endocrine disruptor. So we want to have the elimination of pesticides.
And you say avoid non-essential medical and dental x-rays.
Well, that has to do with radiation, Carl. We know that radiation is cumulative in the body. So basically, when we go, you know, to find out about our knees, to find out about the pain in our arm, we go for dental x-rays. Each doctor says, this x-ray is minor. It's not, you know, it's less than an airplane ride. but we need to know cumulatively how many exposures we have in our life. So medical x-rays contribute to our radiation and our exposures.
And then you say eat organically grown fruits and vegetables.
Well, we're getting there, Carl. So basically, I think, you know, when we go out with Prevention is the Cure, we tell people, if you look at the labels, there are labels on fruits and vegetables, and the first digit of that label is, it's usually four numbers. The first digit, if it's a four, it's been grown, delivered, and put on your plate by using a high amount of pesticides. If the first digit of that PLU code that's on the fruit or vegetable is the number nine, it's organic. So a lot of times we've gone out and spoken to parents about it, and we say, like bananas, for instance, if you pick up a banana, I memorize that code, it's 4011. And basically, moms have come back to me and said, so in the morning when I'm giving my child what I think is really a healthy start to the day, I'm giving my kids an endocrine disruptor. So they go back, they look, and they're now choosing the number nines. A lot of people also have gone into supermarkets and they've seen where organic fruits and vegetables still are a little bit higher than the average vegetable and the average fruit. They're seeing some of the number fours put in the number nine bin. So they go to the manager and say, I'm not gonna pay to have something that is not organic. So we're really moving the market, and it's really important. Your diet does contribute and does become an environmental trigger.
Then there's engage in moderate daily exercise.
Well, we're seeing Michelle Obama take the lead on that when she's like going out and doing the hula hoops and showing that we're never too old. We should never be embarrassed, even in a position of being the First Lady of the United States, to really show that exercise is important and it's fun. And it helps us connect with our neighbors. So I think we need to increase exercise, look at our diet, read labels, and personal behavior is only part of the process.
Avoid synthetic hormones in meat and milk.
So sometimes that's more difficult, and that has a lot of policy implications, because right now we're not really sure that everything is put on labels for us to understand what we're buying from supermarkets. So basically, it's really important to understand and to look at what you're bringing in for your family to eat every day and to make the wise choices. One of the things that we say in Prevention is the Cure is to go on community-supported agriculture. Every single neighborhood has a farmer, and that farmer can bring you fruits and vegetables, dairy, and protein that we know probably is healthier than what we can get in the supermarket. So until really we know that what we are being given, because we need to understand labels, we need to push for more policy so that there's more disclosure and transparency about what's being offered to us in the markets today, we should try to keep our menu simple and know where we're buying our food from. That's something that would be really important and also helps you engage back into your community. Actually, there's an economic factor in that, Carl. It's like healthy economy and, you know, healthy environment, supporting your local community.
And you say seek and use alternative products, but like plastic, so ubiquitous, so prevalent, that's kind of difficult.
I brought a sheet that is a cheat sheet that's on our website. And it's really showing you common products. And in this particular chart, we're looking at only endocrine disruptors. We're looking at parabens, things called parabens, and things called phthalates, and things called triclosan. Basically, these are common, these are uncommon names, but they come to us in a myriad of ways and very common products. So you're seeing that these endocrine disruptors are included in cosmetics. They're included in babies' toys. They're included in food. They're included in antimicrobial soaps. And again, this has a lot to do with political implications. We really need to contact our local and federal policymakers and tell them that we need more transparency. One of the most important things, I think, is as science is providing us with continuous information about the connections between environmental triggers and disease, we need to have that translated and disseminated so that it creates a positive health impact. There's a tremendous gap here between science and political and public health impact. And I think the activist community is trying to fill in those gaps.
And support the precautionary principle. And for people who might not be familiar with the precautionary principle, can you explain it?
So the precautionary principle simply is a better safe than sorry approach. So we've been now looking at how we see a risk and a benefit, and we need to carefully see what science is readily making available to us, and we need to turn that into positive public health impact before our bodies prove them to be harmful. So basically, we're seeing that so many new technologies are coming into the marketplace, and that we're not proving if they're safe before we use them. And we find out later on that we need to be very reactionary. And that's very problematic. So what the precautionary principle states is that first you do no harm. First test your products before they can impact our young children, pregnant mothers, elderly, and people that are vulnerable in our society. So we need to enact the precautionary principle on everything that we do. Very important to promote.
Support increased funding for environmental health research.
So the NIH is made up of 27 agencies, and one of the agencies is the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences. That's an extremely valuable agency that has looked at the environmental triggers of disease, and they include many of the public as stakeholders. They're increasing transparency, and they push for translation and dissemination of science-based information, and they're helping the advocacy community impact public policy by working closely with them. Most recently, we have the Breast Cancer Environmental Research Program, which is an NIEHS and NCI-funded program. And actually, we're looking at environmental triggers and extended environmental triggers and how they affect the onset of disease. We're very happy here in Huntington to be one of the community partners, as with Great Neck, working with Mount Sinai on the Breast Cancer Environmental Program. And we're looking at endocrine disruptors in combinations. I spoke to you before about phthalates and parabens and triclosan. And basically, researchers from Mount Sinai are looking how our exposures to these chemicals in multiplicity affect us early on and in the womb. So I'm very encouraged by the process and what NIEHS and NCI are doing to create a stronger public health impact.
Let's zero in on BPA, a particularly bad actor.
So bisphenol A, or BPA, another endocrine disruptor, was an easy target because it's everywhere. And it was actually used in our most vulnerable, and still is, for our most vulnerable in our population, our babies. BPA is in the lining of tin cans. That means it's in the lining of baby formula. BPA was used in baby bottles and sippy cups. BPA was used when our babies are first born. And what we did was we went to our local Suffolk County, and we got, because if you start locally, actually you can create tremendous change at a federal level. So we went locally to our Suffolk County legislators, and we told them about the science-based information on this endocrine disruptor, BPA. We advocated that BPA and baby bottles and sippy cups need to be eliminated in Suffolk County. When we got that ban, and that was terrific, it started a whole chain of events happening. We had state bans and throughout many states in the United States, and now we're still looking at endocrine disruptors because BPA, the endocrine disruptor, is still among us. BPA is in cash receipts. BPA, as I said before, is in the lining of tin cans. And we need to eliminate it from all the products. And that's going to be take a long time, but we're all growing and we're all involved in the elimination of this very bad actor, bisphenol A or BPA. One of the things that could be a problem is that there seems to be a debate about when to eliminate BPA if you don't have a safe alternative. For instance, an alternative to BPA in cash register receipts is bisphenol S or BPS. And some of us, like people from Prevention is the Cure, say we need to eliminate BPA and tell our neighbors that there still will be a dangerous chemical used in cash receipts, but they need to be aware of it. And again, practically, if you don't need the receipt, don't take it. And at the time that you're looking at the cashier in your market, who's holding those receipts in her hand or his hand every day, you need to tell them to use protection and tell the manager to use protection. So number one, while we're trying to eliminate bisphenol A, an endocrine disruptor, from cash receipts, don't come in contact with all the receipts that we used to think was a safe product.
And flame retardants.
So flame retardants, we've known about flame retardants for a long time. As a matter of fact, so here I am, a grandma, and I was naive then, but I can't hide behind naivete now. So there was a whole thing with having flame retardants in children's pajamas and flame retardants in draperies, and flame retardants were used when using commercial fabrics, and flame retardants were used in mattresses. So we need to know that flame retardants also need to be removed, and we need to have a safer alternative. And right now, we have bills on the floor that are looking at alternatives. We have science looking at alternatives to find a better use so that our children are not exposed to fire, but on the other hand, they're not being exposed to PBDE.
Why isn't the main focus in dealing with cancer and other diseases prevention?
Follow the money, Carl. I think we need to break the chain, and it is a very complicated issue because we know that we have to have a very strong economy and that we have to be competitive in the market. But right now we can do so much because we can actually reinvent ourselves and become the American green marketplace. And we have young minds that are looking at safest alternative. We have information out there, and if we continue to develop products that we know are safe in the market, and we look and track and see how industry has such a hold on bringing down regulations, we need to beef up regulations, we need to make sure that our toxic exposures are reduced, we need to increase how we produce good products in the market, I think that we will make a difference. So basically, one of the things that Prevention is the Cure has put in place about 7 years ago was something called Generations for the Future. We're teaching young high school students the importance of getting into environmental research, of understanding that the things that they thought were safe are not safe, to help them develop a voice so that they can drive the market to become healthier for everybody. and that their children and future generations will then have less exposure.
Is government protecting us?
Well, no, because prevention is the cure always looks at the positive. I think that the advocate community has made tremendous inroads. We're seeing something called partnerships in environment and public health. And it's actually the government has provided resources to bring advocacy organizations together. It's through the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences. And we share what we know would be common threads of environmental exposures. And we work at creating translation and dissemination of information. We work together across the country on how we can affect policy implications. So the Partnerships for Environment and Public Health is really an important and fairly new approach from the government. Another is looking at studies longitudinally. That means looking at studies not in the short term with a 5-year study on what causes this and have to come up with an answer in 3 to 5 years, but looking through a life course and seeing over 21 years how environmental triggers can affect us. So what I'm seeing the government is trying to do is break down these barriers and these gaps, bringing us together to discuss our common problems and then create policy implication that will protect us and that we can speak strongly to our political leaders and say, you need to look at public health first. Public health, we know now that just in childhood diseases alone, annually in New York, we spend over $4 billion, that's 4B with a B, $4 billion, on trying to remediate chronic diseases in children. So when we look at the causes of, and the argument that industry gives us, which is, you know, we're losing dollars at the other end. It's really important to put public health first, and I think we have turned a corner by these new programs that have been put in place by government. But it's really important that the public know that they need to be vigilant, because at any point the pendulum can swing back, and that concerns us. And it goes back to deregulation. It goes back to more exposures without testing. So we need to be watchdogs now and in the future. And most importantly, we need to gather information. We have a website, Prevention is the Cure, that is providing tools for people to know what to avoid and what to choose. So we have healthy reference cards. I want to show them to you. So we have 5 healthy reference cards on our site: healthy home, healthy environment, healthy lifestyle, healthy community, healthy eating cards. It's what to avoid and what to choose. So as we're working together as a community, we can do one thing at a time, one thing once a month, to change our personal behavior. Believe me, Carl, we are consumers and we have the power to change the market. If we buy things that are safe, we can change the market. We can move industry. Our dollar will resonate up and we will change the way the government regulates these policies now. We have something called ribbit.org, which stands for lead, endocrine disruptors, air pollution, and pesticides. And these are endocrine disruptors. So basically, these are things that we can show our kids through coloring books, through games, whoops and wow cards. So we're beginning to change the dialogue. Prevention is the Cure provides a myriad of information so that people can change their personal behavior one at a time. No guilt, one thing at a time. Another thing that we're doing is our Student and Scientist Environmental Research Program. We're into changing how and encouraging how high school students get involved in the environment. So we're really happy, and we're happy to launch our environmental story newspaper, which is focusing on creating a platform for young high school students to have involvement in environmental health.
Karen, how did you personally make the link to prevention is the cure?
Right from the beginning, Carl, I was a runner. I ran 50 miles a week. I was then 127 pounds, a clean machine. There was no cancer in my family. There was heart disease in my family. So when I brought cancer into my family, number one, there was tremendous guilt. And number two, it was, I don't want my children and my grandchildren, then not born, but now born, I have three, to get cancer. It's quite devastating. So we co-opted the four words to really make a difference, because truly, we can't wait for the magic bullet. Prevention is the cure.
How can people and organizations around the country get involved with the Prevention is the Cure effort?
Go on our new website, www.preventionisthecure. You'll see the tools, you'll see the initiatives, you'll see the programs, you'll see the scientists' work, and do something personally for yourself and your family. Speak out, get involved, speak out in your community. You have a voice. Speak to your children. Teach them about endocrine disruptors like pesticides, what to use and what to choose and what to avoid. Get involved.
I started the program by noting that the World Health Organization has declared that cancer is the world's number one fatal disease. The World Health Organization made that announcement in 2010. Did that surprise you, Karen?
Oh, no, absolutely not. But you know what? I think cancer is a window to the other horrific diseases. Because in the end, prevention is the cure is not only dealing with cancer. It says prevention is the cure. So whether or not somebody in your family has a learning disabilities or autism, whether or not they have asthma or Parkinson's or diabetes or cancer or heart disease, we are all facing threats, and we need to end it. We need to see what are those common threads that causes so many diseases that are devastating our families, causing us so much money in medical care. And we need to change that paradigm.
Karen, are you hopeful?
Absolutely, yes. We've got it covered, Carl.
Thank you, Karen Joy Miller, for being with us again.
Thank you, Carl. I really appreciate it.
And thank you for watching. I'm Carl Grossman. This has been Enviro Close-Up. To watch this or any Enviro Close-Up, just visit our website at EnviroVideo.com.